Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents America's Good Terrorist, John Brown and the Harpers Ferry Raid, by Charles P. Poland, Jr. Narrated by David Stifel. Introduction. John Brown is a common name, but the John Brown who masterminded the failed raid at Harpers Ferry in 1859 was anything but common. His thwarted efforts have left an imprint upon our history, and his story still swirls in controversy. Was he a madman who felt his violent solution to slavery was ordained by Providence, or a heroic freedom fighter who tried to liberate the downtrodden slave? These bipolar characterizations of the violent abolitionist have captivated Americans. The prevailing view from the time of the raid to well into the 20th century, that his actions were the product of an unbalanced mind, has shifted to the idea that he committed courageous acts to undo a terrible injustice. The debate still rages, but not as much about his ultimate goal as the method he used in attempting to right what he considered an intolerable wrong. Are citizens justified in bypassing the normal legal or governmental processes in a violent way when these fail, in the eyes of the dissenter, to correct a wrong that touched so many? Brown's use of violence was to strike terror into the hearts of slave owners. Terror that Brown hoped would intimidate them to free their slaves to ensure their families' safety. Terrorism is a frightening element in our lives, especially since 9/11. Modern terrorism is varied and complex. The meaning of terrorism has changed over the last 200 years, making a simple definition difficult. It should not be confused with guerrilla warfare, insurgency, or criminal activity for oneself aggrandizement. The FBI, U.S. Department of Defense, U.S. State Department, U.K. government, and individual authors give different definitions, but most identify the same common elements. David J. Whitaker, editor of the Terrorism Reader, addresses these issues and concludes that the fundamental aim of the terrorist's violence is to change the system, motivated by the altruistic belief that he is serving a good cause designed to achieve a greater good for a wider constituency, whether real or imagined. Terrorists never acknowledge that they are terrorists and go to great lengths to obscure that identity. All terrorist acts, according to Whitaker, involve violence or the threat of violence. He defines terrorism as the deliberate creation and exploitation of fear through violence or the threat of violence in the pursuit of political change. Advancements in communication and weaponry technology have enabled modern terrorists to target indiscriminately and to inflict mayhem on civilians. Despite the differences between modern terrorist acts and Brown's own violent acts, when Brown's characteristics are compared to the definition of terrorism as set forth by scholars of terrorism, he fits the profile. Nevertheless, today Brown is a martyred hero who gave his life attempting to terminate the evil institution of human bondage. Brown's violent method of using terrorism to accomplish this is downplayed or ignored, despite his labeling by historians as America's first terrorist. The modern view of Brown has unintentionally made him a good terrorist, despite the repugnance of terrorism that makes the thought of a benevolent or good terrorist an oxymoron. The title, America's Good Terrorist, reflects the shift in view of the violent abolitionist from villain to hero, and does not imply terrorism is benevolent. Chapter 1. The Making of a Terrorist. Nature's grandeur at Harpers Ferry laid an engaging stage for one of America's great dramas, John Brown's Raid. The setting was a relatively small town, walled in by water and cliffs, some 60 miles west of the nation's capital, by rail 70 miles west of Baltimore, and 170 miles north of the Old Dominion's capital, Richmond. Captain Brown's War of Liberation would bring excitement and anxiety of a magnitude previously unknown at Harpers Ferry. The raid had shocking repercussions that strained the political sinews binding the nation together, strained them almost to the point of rupture. But this raid was only the beginning. The residents of this town, located in an area of such unusual geographic beauty, had no way of knowing what impending trauma and change would invade their world. The Golden Age of Harpers Ferry. The town's businesses clustered along the Potomac and Shenandoah shores, on a neck of land shaped like a shark's head. The river's water powered the town's mills and factories. The Civil War and later floods would destroy and sweep away most of these businesses and the homes on the Shenandoah bank. Today, the surrounding heights around Harpers Ferry, the confluence of two rivers, and remaining historic structures still provide magnificent scenery for gawking tourists, though most of the structures that were focal points during the abolitionist raid have disappeared. Buildings hugging the cliffs or nearby along Shenandoah Street still stand, along with those on the lower part of High Street and North Potomac Street, next to the Armory site, which housed early businesses. Modern tourists may see dwellings such as the Harper House, which sits on rising terrain traversed by High Street. The most dramatic vista is still obtained by trudging up the stone steps to St. Peter's Catholic Church, then continuing on the path past the remains of St. John's Episcopal Church to Jefferson's Rock. Behind it, on even higher ground, is a 4-acre burial site, containing among the still and quiet remains those of the town's founder, Robert Harper. Further up on a plateau are several historic houses and buildings on Camp Hill, used in the 19th and 20th centuries by Storer College for African Americans. Gone are the numerous structures that formed the town's heart. Only remnants remain of two of the three canals. The only building left on the outer rim of low land is the much-moved engine house, better known as John Brown's Fort. The bridges that replaced the two covered toll crossings have also been moved. Stone walls still frame the tip of land, but the one along the Potomac is all that remains of the masonry that surrounded the quarter-mile-long United States musket factory, the Armory, that once consisted of 21 buildings. No trace can be found of the United States Canal, which entered from the west to power the Armory's turbines. The modern visitor will only find railroad tracks, a train station, scattered loose railroad ties, and numerous unfriendly no trespassing signs on 20-foot-high mounds of fill dirt running through what was the federal government's largest arms plant. These mounds obscure any view of the original armory grounds. The nose of the shark's head, called the Point, was once home to a toll house, two rail depots, the Potomac Restaurant, Wagner House, and Galt House Saloon. All are gone. Just to the south, only vague and sunken outlines remain of the two arsenal buildings. Along the Shenandoah bank, wilderness hides the rail tracks to Winchester and covers land that was once three islands, Upper Hall, Lower Hall, and Virginius, that collectively form the outline of the Shark's Mouth. The Shenandoah Canal separates the islands from town, and the Shenandoah River borders them on the other side. A curving dam once funneled water to power machinery in most of the nine buildings of the rifle works on Lower Hall Island, as well as Virginius Island's tannery and iron, flour, saw, and cotton mills. In warm weather, tourists swarm the remains of the historic sites. Harper's Ferry of the 1850s was a thriving town nearing the end of its golden age. It was the site of numerous businesses, The most important was arms manufacturing. The U.S. Armory, the arsenal, the rifle factory, and other businesses employed a large number of the white wage earners among the town's 2,500 residents, half white and half black. The majority of the white residents were from the north, considered foreigners by those of southern heritage, and provided skilled workers for the town, as well as artisans for the government armory and for Hall's Rifle Works, which produced nearly 9,000 stands of arms in 1859. The region's economy did not foster large plantations and slaveholding. Although Harpers Ferry had 1,339 black residents, only 88 were enslaved. The six Virginia and Maryland counties surrounding the town had a white population of 115,000 and 18,048 black people who were enslaved, of whom fewer than 5,000 were men. Free blacks in these counties numbered 9,800. In the Old Dominion at the time, a third of the residents were in bondage. Railroads were integral to the town's prosperity, especially the Baltimore and Ohio, or B&O, which made Harpers Ferry an important rail link between the East and the Ohio Valley. An additional railroad and canal supplemented the B&O, the Winchester and Potomac Railroad, which joined the B&O line at Harpers Ferry, and the Chesapeake and Ohio Canal, which followed the meandering northern banks of the Potomac River from Washington, D.C. to Cumberland, Maryland. The Federal Armory had its genesis during the presidency of George Washington, who was impressed with the regional abundance of elements necessary for arms production: water power, iron ore, and hardwood timber. In 1796, the federal government purchased land from the heirs of Robert Harper, and that land became the site of the armory, then in the state of Virginia. Production started in 1798. Economic growth and technological advancements in arms production caused growing pains for the area during its pre-Civil War golden age. Locals had lived in an isolated environment prior to the 1830s, and they clung to craft production and were slow to adopt technological advances because they feared these would bring lower wages. Federal authorities instituted measures to heighten control over arms production to eliminate lax work habits, such as employees arriving at and leaving work whenever they wished. The people of Harpers Ferry resented the increased federal control, considering it an unwarranted intrusion upon the independence and the rights of the worker. Prior to John Brown's raid, workers were similarly displeased with Superintendent Alfred M. Barber's firing of more than 100 workers. Those who were retained took a 10% reduction in wages and had to abide by more rigid regulations. Harpers Ferry's unique setting has impressed travelers since the colonial era. A Philadelphia architect, Robert Harper, was so enamored with the region known as the Hole, or Peter's Hole, that in 1747 he purchased the land there from the first settler, ferry operator Peter Stevens. Harper's purchase and improvement of the ferry service resulted in a name change to Harper's Ferry. Thomas Jefferson, in his Notes on Virginia, wrote about the area, apparently from a viewpoint on what has since been called Jefferson's Rock. He described the confluence of the Potomac and the Shenandoah rivers and the mountains that bordered them as one of the most stupendous scenes in nature. God's Avenger. Such was the setting John Brown selected for his attack upon slavery, an attack that the old man, as acquaintances and the press called him, believed would terminate that evil institution. But it was not the grandeur of the scenery that attracted Brown. Instead, it was the existence of the U.S. Arms facilities at Harpers Ferry. a town located in a border region that Brown wrongly assumed would supply numerous black and white supporters who would liberate the slaves through guerrilla warfare. The original appeal of seizing federal property to obtain weapons for those he planned to liberate seemed to be less a motive at the time of the raid. By then, Brown had weapons for them. By 1859, he had more important motivations: retribution against a government that would protect slavery, and the publicity from such a bold act. Brown assumed this raid would launch his revolution. An additional attraction was the town's proximity to a mountain chain that Brown could retreat to and use as an avenue for deeper penetration into the slave kingdom. Several threads ran through John Brown's life: business failure, debt, abolition, and religion. He enjoyed early business success, evolving from shepherd, tanner, farmer, and cattleman to real estate speculator and wool merchant, but fell upon difficult times. From 1831 to 1853, he was constantly in debt as a result of 15 business failures. Brown's dependence on credit, lack of judgment, and stubbornness doomed him in business deals. Debt frequently landed him in court, and by 1842 he was bankrupt. Brown headed a large household, and possessions were sparse. At one point, 12 Brown children slept in 5 beds. The family's austere life included plain clothing and food. Milk and water were their only drinks, although later in his life Brown sipped tea or coffee to avoid offending a well-meaning hostess. Tobacco and liquor were forbidden, and for some reason John would never eat butter. The one thing the Brown household had in abundance reflected John's priority in life: religion. They owned 11 Bibles and half a dozen New Testaments. Brown's first wife, Dianthe Lusk Brown, delivered 7 children in 12 years of marriage. In 1832, she died of heart failure 3 days after giving birth to a stillborn son. Brown lost 9 of his 20 children, 7 from his second marriage. While living in Ohio, Brown and his second wife, Mary Ann Day Brown, lost 3 children to dysentery within 11 days. 9-year-old Sarah, 2-year-old Peter, and 1-year-old Austin were buried in the same grave as their 4-year-old brother Charles, who had died 2 years earlier. Those years proved to be decades of frustration and despair. Why did John Brown attack Harpers Ferry in an attempt to end what he considered America's greatest sin? One must look at the dominant anti-slavery influences in his life. His father, an abolitionist environment, Calvinism, slave revolts, Oliver Cromwell, guerrilla warfare, and a belief the government was guilty of malfeasance. John Brown's anti-slavery feelings formed in his early years. He was born in Torrington, Connecticut, on May 9, 1800, to Owen and Ruth Brown. His mother was the daughter of a Congregational minister, for whom John was named. In the 1850s, John Brown briefly sketched his childhood in an essay, A Boy Named John. It was written in response to a request from one of his financial backers, Henry Stearns, and it focused on Brown's youthful errors, in hopes young Stearns would avoid them. The autobiography tells of the struggles and hard work in Connecticut and on the frontier in Ohio, of Brown's dislike of school, and of his proclivity to lie to avoid punishment. It also tells of traumatic events, including his mother's death, losses of a yellow marble and a bobtailed squirrel, the death of his pet lamb, and the horror of seeing a young slave boy about his age beaten by a master with a shovel. At times during his youth, Brown wrote, he had a strong desire to die. Brown had his lighter moments, often engaging in pranks. In his significant biography of Brown, Oswald Villard tells an unsubstantiated story of John's attempt to ignite gunpowder under his stepmother and then patting his pants to counter the sting of his father's thrashing. Hijinks aside, adult responsibilities were thrust upon John when he was barely an adolescent. When the War of 1812 started, Owen sent his young son alone, barefoot and dressed in buckskins, to drive cattle over 100 miles of wilderness from Ohio to outposts in Michigan. John was raised to revere strict Puritan values, and he was shocked by contact with the undisciplined, cussing, complaining soldiers. The shame of General William Hull's surrender of Detroit further disillusioned him. John's disdain for the military carried through into adulthood, when he refused to show up for mandatory militia drills, instead opting to pay fines. At 16, John was preparing to enter the ministry, but an eye infection and lack of funds doomed this ambition. He left school and returned to Ohio. Owen Brown had a profound influence upon his son. John's father, who was restless and moved frequently, was a stern disciplinarian who was liberal in his use of corporal punishment, a common practice of that era. A religiously devout man who was strongly opposed to slavery, Owen stuttered severely, except when praying. Like his father, John would later move from place to place. Corporal punishment was passed down as well. John Brown whipped his sons, especially his older sons. When 3-year-old Jason claimed a dream was real, John punished him for lying. John also kept a detailed account book of his son John Jr.'s sinful acts and the number of whiplashes each merited. John Jr. recalled that one Sunday morning, his father said it was time for settlement. He recounted, "After a long and tearful talk over my faults, he again showed me my account. I paid about 1/3 the debt from a nicely prepared blue beach switch. Then, to my utter astonishment, Father took off his shirt and gave me the whip." The senior John Brown told the son to whip his bare back and to strike harder and harder as he took the remaining lashes for his son. Historians James Davidson and Mark Little contend that Owen's harsh treatment of John led to a deep feeling of loyalty and submission, countered by a strong desire for independence. John's similar treatment of his sons caused Watson Brown to tell his father, "The trouble is, Father, you want your boys to be brave as tigers and still afraid of you." Yet John Brown was remembered fondly by his daughter Annie, a product of his second marriage. She recalled not just a rigorous disciplinarian, but a caring, loving father. "He was very strict in his ideas of discipline, but he played with his children often and waited upon and cared for us at night. He never complained about getting up in the middle of a cold night and drawing a bucket of water to fetch his daughter a drink, because he said that water that stood in the house was not good to drink. Before going to bed, he bounced Annie on his knee and carried her about, singing her to sleep and tucking her into bed. He continued the practice until she was nearly 8. She sat on his lap during business meetings, taking everything out of her papa's pockets to play with, and then carefully returning the items. He told Annie and her siblings stories and riddles, and amused them by making shadow pictures of animals on the wall with his hands. Annie recalled, "He seldom ever came home from an absence of even a day without bringing the children something, such as oranges, nuts, raisins, and fruits, or popcorn, never candy, but books for those who were old enough to read. All children who were with him for a short time formed a strong attachment for him." The paramount influence of Owen Brown upon John was in religion and a hatred of slavery. Owen was a descendant of Peter Brown, who supposedly came over on the Mayflower in 1620, though records indicate Peter probably arrived a dozen years later. Owen felt people were, in the words of Jonathan Edwards, "sinners in the hands of an angry God." Owen was an Orthodox Congregationalist and accepted Calvin's view of humans as wicked and feeble creatures whose duty was to resist Satan's temptations and live a life of Christian piety. In his early years, John considered becoming a minister, and he embraced his father's Calvinist view of a God of wrath and revenge, as well as the doctrine of predestination. As an adult, John Brown diligently studied Jonathan Edwards's On the Freedom of Will, which fueled his evangelical fever. It also prepared him to debate a pious, overconfident minister who, in their first argument, drowned out Brown's refuting of the doctrines of perfectionism and free will. Afterwards, Brown said the preacher was not a gentleman. Word of this traveled back to the minister, who confronted Brown. Not only did Brown take ownership of the statement, but he pointed out that he had also said, "It would take as many men like you to make a gentleman as it would take hens to make a cock turkey." Annoyed, the preacher engaged Brown in a second verbal sparring, and onlookers said Brown won the debate. Brown was devout, and religion so pervaded his daily life that he often turned business transactions into occasions for religious lectures and discussions. No book received more of his time than the Bible, especially the Old Testament. Brown felt he had found his commission from God there, and he marked Old Testament passages about God's wrath in bringing about the slaughter of the wicked and the enemies of God's chosen people. Both Owen and John believed it was their Christian duty to fight wickedness, and in their eyes, the greatest wickedness in the U.S. was slavery. Owen chose to fight slavery with the Underground Railroad, while John sought a violent solution. Years of studying Jehovah's violent destruction of the enemies of righteousness convinced John that God had chosen him to take action against slaveholders. His credo was one of his favorite marked passages, "Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sins." He also sanctified the use of violence while talking with Ralph Waldo Emerson at the Transcendentalist's home in the late 1850s. Brown said he believed in the Bible and the Declaration of Independence, and said, "Better that a whole generation of men, women, and children should pass away by a violent death than a word of either should be violated." One of Brown's favorite biblical characters was Gideon. Under divine orders, Gideon delivered the Israelites from hordes of Midianites, who for years raided on Camelback, plundering, burning, and conducting massacres. Gideon claimed God had assured him a victory if he reduced his forces from thousands to 300. He divided his small force into three companies and startled the enemy in a surprise night attack. His men blew their trumpets and revealed lamps they had hidden inside pitchers, shouting, "A sword for the Lord and for Gideon!" Confused enemy troops attacked each other and fled, and Gideon won. This tale made an indelible impression on John Brown. Gideon's small force was victorious against the overwhelming numbers of an evil enemy. He used violence and an element of surprise to carry out God's will in a unique nighttime attack. Brown's study of violence in Triumph Over Evil was not limited to his holy book. It extended to select aspects of history and to leaders who felt their violent acts were part of a divine mission, especially Spartacus, Cinque, Nat Turner, and Oliver Cromwell. Brown admired slaves who had led rebellions, but his idealization of them, as David S. Reynolds argues in his extensive biography, John Brown, Abolitionist, made Brown believe he would successfully spur a slave insurrection throughout the U.S. slave states. The life of Spartacus, who headed the most formidable of the many slave rebellions in Roman history, was also of great interest to Brown. Spartacus escaped from gladiator school to the mountains. Other men fleeing the cruel mistreatments of slavery joined him. and they formed an army that terrorized and laid waste to a large region, from the Alps to the southern tip of the peninsula, repeatedly defeating the powerful Roman legions. After 2 years, the insurrection was crushed. Spartacus was slain, and 6,000 of his followers were crucified on the Appian Way to Rome as a warning to slaves. John Brown admired Cinque, who led a slave revolt upon a Spanish vessel, Amistad, while it was on the high seas. Nat Turner, who led a bloody insurrection in Virginia in 1831, was also especially revered. Brown would later emulate Turner's tactics by launching nighttime terrorist attacks at Pottawatomie Creek and Harpers Ferry. Inspired by Turner's use of crude weapons, Brown's men would use swords to hack their victims to death at Pottawatomie Creek, and Brown ordered 1,000 pikes to arm the slaves he expected to join him at Harpers Ferry. Brown's favorite historical figure was Oliver Cromwell, whom Brown patterned his life after so much that contemporaries called him the Second Cromwell. Both had an agrarian background, were devoted Puritans, cared little about the state of their clothing, and believed they were commissioned by God to right wrongs through violence. Brown studied his second favorite book, Joel Tyler Headley's The Life of Oliver Cromwell, a sympathetic biography of the man who led the Republican forces in the English Civil Wars, overthrowing the monarchy and beheading King Charles I. Cromwell became a dictator in the name of ruling a republic and vigorously pursued his enemies, Catholics in Ireland, Royalists in Scotland, and radical Republicans such as the Levellers in England. Brown read with keen interest of Cromwell's sense of divine mission and his speech to his people upon arriving in Ireland. God has brought us here in safety. We are here to carry on the work against the barbarous and bloodthirsty Irish, to propagate the gospel of Christ and restore the establishment of truth, and to restore this nation to its former happiness and tranquility. Cromwell invaded Ireland in 1649 with an army of 12,000 men to create a godly Protestant society. His army slaughtered civilians as well as soldiers, and specifically carried out Cromwell's orders to kill priests, monks, and nuns. Catholic boys and girls were shipped to Barbados and sold as slaves. Catholic lands were confiscated. In the decade after Cromwell's arrival, about one-third of the Irish had been killed or died of starvation. Cromwell took a similar hard stand in dealing with the Levellers' mutiny. You must cut these people in pieces, or they will cut you in pieces. Inspired by his role models, Brown was convinced he was not only justified in carrying out the Pottawatomie Creek massacre and the raid on Harper's Ferry, but was following divine and historical precedent. Brown pored over history books that dealt with guerrilla activities and insurrections. He was enamored with how the Portuguese guerrillas held their own against Napoleon's army in the Pyrenees, how the Maroons, slaves who rebelled against their Spanish masters, fled to the wilderness and formed communities that they defended with guerrilla tactics, and how Toussaint Louverture liberated Haiti in a bloody struggle with Napoleon's forces. In his memorandum book, Brown copied select pages from Joachim H. Stockwiller's The Life of Field Marshal the Duke of Wellington, published in 1852. He included details of Spanish guerrilla activity under the capable leadership of Mina, descriptions of broken mountainous terrain, and instructions for discipline and cooking. The notations included, see also, same book, page 235, these words, deep and narrow defiles, where 300 men would suffice to check an army. Brown was convinced that with help, slaves could gain their freedom and form independent mountain communities. The shivering fear and panic that swept over the South after Nat Turner's revolt in 1831 in southern Virginia convinced Brown of the value of using terror as a psychological weapon in destabilizing the institution of human bondage. Turner was a slave and self-appointed preacher who had visions and believed a solar eclipse was a divine signal to free the slaves. He gathered about 60 other men who were enslaved, many of whom were emboldened by stolen brandy, and led them on a killing spree. They took the lives of nearly 60 children, women, and men. The massacre began with his mild-mannered master and mistress. A hatchet and axe were used to hack them to death as they lay in their bed. Soon thereafter, their baby was taken by its legs, and its brains were smashed out upon a brick fireplace. The gruesome slaughter continued for several days. Fence rails, swords, razors, knives, and guns were also used to dispatch victims, whether they slept or fought back. Women fled their homes in terror, pleading for their lives, but were ruthlessly killed. Children were decapitated. The massacre's impact was seared upon the memory of Southern whites. Its impact was not lessened by the capture, execution, and deportation of the insurrectionists, or by the fidelity of young Dr. Simon Blunt's slaves. After they were given a choice between fighting and leaving, they used hoes and pitchforks to drive away a surprised Turner and his mob. Brown also learned from an uneducated ex-slave from Maryland, the indomitable Harriet Tubman, whom he called the general of us all. The Appalachian chain that penetrated the heart of the slave states was, he said, a veritable land of refuge. In 1858, he expressed to Wendell Phillips, a pioneer of abolitionism, that Tubman had used those mountains as the road to lead members of her enslaved race from bondage to comparative freedom. When introducing her to Phillips, Brown said, "I bring you one of the best and bravest persons on this continent, General Tubman, as we call her." He explained she was the most of any man, naturally, that I ever met with. Tubman was called Moses by those who sought freedom. Her dark skin bore the scars of beatings, but gone was the reputation she carried through early adolescence, when an overseer threw a weight at her. She suffered a severe head injury and was seen as a dim-witted person. According to her abolitionist friend, Sarah Bradford, who embellished Tubman's exploits, Harriet completed most of her 19 trips to free more than 300 slaves by taking different routes, including, after 1850, the scenic route to Canada by Niagara Falls. Her violation of fugitive slave laws led to collective rewards placed upon her head that supposedly amounted to $40,000. In reality, it was $300. Tubman shepherded her flock through rain, snow, and swamps, carrying sleeping children in their arms and babies in baskets. Young ones were given opium to prevent betraying sounds. To stave off hunger, Tubman traded her undergarments for food. She silently prayed for God's guidance and avoided seemingly certain capture. Brown's admiration for Tubman was almost boundless. She was fearless and uncompromising and tolerated no whining, threatening to shoot anyone who wanted to return to their master. Brown believed she was a valuable ally in getting recruits from Canada and leading the slaves he would liberate from Harpers Ferry to freedom. In his 1857 autobiography, in which he refers to himself curiously in the third person, Brown wrote that early in his life he became a most determined abolitionist. This belief led him to declare, or swear, eternal war with slavery. Despite his claims, Brown's plans for attacking slavery emerged sporadically during a period of frequent financial and personal travails in the 1830s and 1840s. Although he claimed to have declared eternal war with slavery at age 12, not until 1834, at age 35, was there documented evidence of his wish. This desire to help people in bondage seemed to reach fruition in 1837, when a mob in Illinois attacked the office of anti-slavery editor Elijah P. Lovejoy, killing him. This repugnant act shocked Northerners, driving Abraham Lincoln toward moderation and anti-slavery activists such as William Lloyd Garrison to spurn violence in answer to slavery. Meanwhile, the murder fired Brown's anti-slavery passions to a new level. While listening to a eulogy for the slain Lovejoy, Brown and his father were deeply moved by the speaker's harangues against slavery and Southern mob law. Legend claims that when the meeting was ended, John Brown rose from his seat, raised his right hand, and proclaimed to the world, "Here before God, in the presence of these witnesses from this time, I consecrate my life to the destruction of slavery." In the 1830s, Brown's plans were relatively benign and nonviolent, in keeping with other abolitionists' attitudes. He wanted to adopt a Negro boy and start a school for black people in Pennsylvania or Canada, but a lack of money and time doomed this goal. In the late 1840s, he published an article entitled "Sambo's Mistakes" in a little-known abolitionist newspaper, The Ram's Horn, published and edited by blacks in New York. In the article, he urged black people to seek self-improvement and resistance. It was written from the viewpoint of a free black man who admits his minor foibles of wasting time and money, and of devouring silly novels and other miserable trash as newspapers, instead of giving my attention to sacred and profane history, which I might have become acquainted with the true character of God and of man. Especially significant was Sambo's admission, "I have always expected to secure the favor of the whites by tamely submitting to every species of indignity, contempt, and wrong, instead of nobly resisting their brutal aggressions from principle and taking my place as a man and assuming the responsibilities of a man, a citizen, a husband, a father, a brother, a neighbor, a friend." Sambo personified Brown's belief that black people had the capacity not only for self-improvement, but also for being equal to whites. At the time, for a white man, the concept was revolutionary. In 1890, John Brown Jr. wrote that around 1840, his father had his wife Mary and three teenage sons, John Jr., 19, Jason, 16, and Owen, 14 or 15, swear they would do all in their power to abolish slavery. The place and the circumstances where he first informed us of that purpose are as perfectly in my memory as any other event in my life. Father, Mother, Jason, Owen, and I were, late in the evening, seated around the fire in the open fireplace of the kitchen, in the old haymaker house where we then lived, and there he first informed us of his determination to make war on slavery. Not such war as Mr. Garrison informs us was equally the purpose of the non-resistant abolitionists, but war by force and arms. He said that he had long entertained such a purpose, that he believed it his duty to devote his life, if need be, to this object, which he made us fully understand. After spending considerable time in setting forth in most impressive language the hopeless condition of the slave, he asked who of us were willing to make common cause with him in doing all in our power to break the jaws of the wicked and pluck the spoil out of his teeth, naming each of us in succession. Are you Mary, John, Jason, and Owen? Receiving an affirmative answer from each, he kneeled in prayer, and all did the same. This posture in prayer impressed me greatly, as it was the first time I had ever known him to assume it. After prayer, he asked us to raise our right hands, and he then administered to us an oath, the exact terms of which I cannot recall. But in substance, it bound us to secrecy and devotion to the purpose of fighting slavery by force and arms to the extent of our ability. By the late 1840s, Brown's views and proposals were becoming more militant. He had open discussions with blacks to try to recruit them. In 1847, at his first meeting with Frederick Douglass in Springfield, Massachusetts, he discussed a scheme of guerrilla activity that was the closest that Brown had to a master plan. A former slave and leading black abolitionist, Douglass would become a close friend of Brown's. Douglass was opposed to violence. He tells of a conversation with Brown, who bitterly denounced slavery. Brown felt slaveholders had forfeited their right to live, that slaves had the right to gain liberty in any way they could, did not believe that moral suasion would ever liberate the slave, or that political action would abolish the system. Brown laid out a U.S. map on the table for his dinner guest, an intrigued but somewhat skeptical Douglass, and pointed out how the Appalachian mountain chain extended from Maine to Georgia. "These mountains are the basis of my plan," he told Douglass. "God has given the strength of the hills to freedom. They were placed here for the emancipation of the Negro race. They are full of natural forts, where one man for defense will equal to 100 for attack." He informed the self-educated and eloquent Douglass, "The mountains are full of good hiding places, where large numbers of brave men could be concealed and baffle and elude pursuit for a long time. I know these mountains well, and could take a body of men into them and keep them there despite all the efforts of Virginia to dislodge them. The true object to be sought first of all is to destroy the money value of slave property, and this can only be done by rendering such property insecure. This in turn would compel slave owners, out of paralyzing fear for their safety, to free their slaves." Brown told Douglass he planned to take a select group of 25 men, divided into groups of 5, to terrorize slave owners. They would raid plantations, free slaves, and retreat to the safety of the mountains, whose inhabitants were non-slave owners who had been squeezed off the fertile Piedmont by slave owners. Those enslaved people who did not wish to colonize in the mountains could escape the South by traveling north. Brown confided to Douglass that he did not want unnecessary combat, but if they were attacked, the situation was to be made as costly as possible for his assailants. His intent was not to bring about a general slave insurrection and slaughter of slave masters, but to begin on a small scale, posting his 25 hand-picked men in squads of 5 on a line of 25 miles. "The most persuasive and judicious of these shall go down from the mountains," said Brown, "to the fields from time to time, as opportunity offers, and induce slaves to join them, seeking and selecting the restless and daring." When 100 carefully selected slaves were gathered, they would be well-armed and entrenched in mountain forts, using draws and ravines to ambush the enemy. Brown had worked for Oberlin College surveying land given to the college, and he was familiar with the Virginia mountains. "If the slaves could be driven out of one county," he reasoned, "the whole system would be weakened in that state." Douglass responded, "But they would employ bloodhounds to hunt you out of the mountains." Brown replied, "The chances are we should whip them, and when you have whipped one squad, they would be careful how they pursued." Still not convinced, Douglass said, "But you might be surrounded and cut off from your provisions or means of subsistence." The former slave, an orator, would later write that Brown thought this could not be done, but even if the worst came, he could but be killed, and he had no better use for his life than to lay it down in the cause of the slave. Douglass suggested converting the slaveholders rather than fighting. Brown became excited, or perhaps agitated, and said they would never be induced to give up their slaves until they felt a big stick about their heads. Brown said that his simple lifestyle was meant solely to save money to carry out his mission, and he had already delayed too long. The night that Frederick Douglass spent with John Brown in Springfield gradually shifted Douglass's approach away from ending slavery by peaceful abolition. While speaking at an anti-slavery convention in Ohio, Douglass was interrupted by his good friend, the former slave sojourner Truth, with the question, "Frederick, is God dead?" "No," he answered. "And because God is not dead, slavery shall only end in blood." Sojourner, who believed in the Garrison School of nonviolence, was shocked, but she too would become an advocate of the sword. Violence is the way to freedom. In 1850, Brown traveled to Europe to sell wool. It was an unsuccessful financial venture, but he used the trip to research his plan. In Great Britain, France, Germany, and Austria, he examined forts, studied military plans and ordnance, and observed soldiers. He came back even more convinced of the value of building forts in the eastern mountains. He planned to conceal forts in trees and thickets and connect them by secret passages for easy evacuation. If militiamen or bloodhounds pursued Brown's men, the pursuers would be unable to cut off significant areas or food supplies and would meet their demise at hidden forts. Brown's guerrilla force would live off sustenance taken from the planters. They could subsist for several days on wild animals, roots, and fruit. Brown's tactics were to be a modified and more militant version of the running off slaves of the Underground Railroad, and an expanded version of what he would do in Missouri in 1858. The difference was that most of the runaways would take refuge in southern mountains and swamps. In the late 1840s or early 1850s, after he first met with Douglass, Harpers Ferry became his primary target. His young daughter Annie said her father told her about Harpers Ferry nearly a decade before the attack. By the 1850s, however, Brown's militancy was calling him to action. Implementation still remained hazy, but his dedication to the violent assault on slavery was absolute. His inflexibility of purpose is illustrated by his words to a friend in 1858. "For 20 years I have never made any business arrangements which would prevent me at any time answering the call of the Lord. I have permitted nothing to be in way of my duty, neither wife, child, nor worldly goods. The hour is near at hand, and all who are willing to act should be ready." The forcible termination of slavery was now what he called his greatest or principal object of his life. In Brown's mind, slavery was a state of war to which slaves were unwilling parties, and consequently they have, as he told Douglass, a right to do anything necessary to obtain their peace and freedom. He said to another friend, James Redpath, "Any resistance, however bloody, is better than the system which makes every seventh woman a concubine." His ultimate goal was constant, but his immediate objectives were more changeable. Brown talked of using terror to devalue slavery, and at times he planned to capture and govern a significant section of the United States. He claimed, "The land belongs to the bondman. He has enriched it and been robbed of its fruits." During the years he spent in Kansas in the 1850s, he first wanted to relieve Kansas by striking elsewhere, mainly Harper's Ferry. After going to Kansas, he sought to create a situation where the pro-slavery and anti-slavery factions would fight it out. He continued to believe in this approach after the fighting between pro-slavery and anti-slavery settlers during the mid-1850s, referred to as Bleeding Kansas. He wanted to provoke Southerners to follow through on their threats to secede, so the North would whip the South back into the Union without slavery. Brown freely told prospective recruits of his plan, and he probably told Colonel Daniel Woodruff, a friend and veteran of the War of 1812, when they talked during the Kansas conflict in the mid-1850s. Brown is said to have vividly described the details of the evils in Kansas. He wished to relieve Kansas by striking Harpers Ferry. Such a strike would terrorize Virginia, detaching it from the slave interests, capturing rifles to arm slaves, and destroying government facilities and stored arms that could not be carried off. Brown would later change his objectives. In the extensive orders he issued just before the celebrated raid, he would not mention the seizure of government weapons. Brown's most intent listeners were family members. They were his sounding board. All the children knew Harper's Ferry was to be struck. Owen Brown later wrote he grew up with the expectation of going with his father whenever he should attempt to carry out his plan. While in North Elba, New York, from 1849 to 1851, Brown talked openly to his family about attacking Harper's Ferry. Daughter Sarah recalled standing behind her father's chair, watching him sketch plans for forts to be built in the mountains near Harper's Ferry. She listened to him explain the placement of logs, the construction of roofs, and how trees could be felled and laid as obstacles for attackers. Another daughter, Annie Brown Adams, would later state, "I think I may say without any intention of boasting that I knew more about his plans than anyone else, or at least anyone else who survived to tell the tale. He always talked freely to me of his plans, from the time he first explained them to me, the winter before he went to Kansas, when I was 11 years old, in 1854. After revealing his plans, she said, he would say, as if for a sort of apology to himself, perhaps, "I know I can trust you. You never tell anything you are told not to." She indeed kept his secret, but not without stress. Annie recalled that when Harper's Ferry entered into a school lesson, her heart hammered and she shivered as with a cold. Not all who heard Brown's plan for Harper's Ferry felt it was the best site to attack. It was too close to the nation's capital and too easy to reach on the rail lines. Destroying federal property would bring swift reprisal and certain defeat. Brown's son Salmon reveals that his dad did waver in his convictions and indicated his intent to launch his revolution elsewhere, including sites in the lower South. In the mid to late 1850s, the patriarch listed in his memorandum book these potential sites: Little Rock, Arkansas; Charleston, South Carolina; San Antonio, Texas; St. Louis, Missouri; Augusta, Georgia; and four Pennsylvania cities. Long a person of inflexible opinions and indomitable will, Brown had finally found specific direction and purpose. More than ever, he believed that the sins of slavery must be atoned in blood, and that he was the instrument of God to accomplish this. Brown would devote his life in the 1850s almost exclusively to fighting slavery. His militant actions were in part triggered by the government's passing of laws that were, in his eyes, abominably wicked and unjust: the Fugitive Slave Act of 1850 and the Kansas-Nebraska Act of 1854. Slaveholding interests dominated the Democratic Party and controlled the federal government, and Brown had no faith in the political process. He did not see a viable way to end slavery with the Republican Party or abolitionist organizations. Their tepid solutions shied away from violence, the only answer to Brown, making them unappealing. "Talk was a national institution," Brown said, "but it did not help the slave." In Kansas, Brown felt the anti-slave forces were weak in resolve and tactics. He felt justified in acting independently and made little effort to coordinate his military activities with other free state forces. Brown was nearing the position of an anarchist, although he wanted to reform, not abolish, government. He believed a higher moral law dictated that he must act outside and against the law. In 1851, Brown formed a militant organization of blacks in the Springfield, Massachusetts area. Their purpose was to enable black men and women, by secret resolve, to violently resist attempts to enforce the fugitive slave law. Brown assumed the mantle of a modern Gideon by attempting to raise a small army against pro-slavery forces. He named his organization after Mount Gilead, where Gideon was told by God to free his people from invaders. The United League of Gileadites was Brown's first attempt to organize slaves to defend themselves while seeking freedom. It was an attempt to prevent slave catchers in the North from capturing and returning runaway slaves to their masters. Slave catchers' actions were sanctioned under the Fugitive Slave Act of 1850, an act Brown felt that God meant as a warning to slave owners and a signal to enslaved people to defend themselves. Brown instructed more than 40 black recruits, many escaping through Springfield by the Underground Railroad, to arm themselves so they could swiftly kill marshals sent to return them to bondage. After killing the marshals, they would flee to the homes of sympathetic whites if necessary. If they were captured and taken to court, which in most cases would result in being sent back south, then other Gileadites were to smuggle gunpowder into the courtroom, create a diversion by lighting it, and free their comrade. In the mid-1850s, Brown followed his sons to Kansas, a territory beset by tension over slavery and brutal acts committed by settlers on both sides. Brown's original intent was to temporarily and peacefully assist his two eldest sons' settlement on the frontier and return to his family in North Elba, New York, but plans changed. Brown later told a friend that fighting in the Kansas Territory never entered his mind until he heard the Missourians were planning to come into Kansas to vote. Stimulated by the warlike atmosphere, he sought revenge for numerous atrocities, particularly the attack made by pro-slavery settlers upon Lawrence, Kansas, that resulted in the killing of two free state men. Revenge took shape on a spring night in 1856, when Brown and seven men brutally murdered and mutilated five pro-slavery settlers in Pottawatomie, Kansas. Brown's so-called Army of the North, frenzied by the news of the caning of an abolitionist senator, Charles Sumner, went to three homes in the dead of night, dispatching or scaring away barking dogs and knocking on doors. They awakened the inhabitants, who found a tall, begrimed old man with a thin face in dirty clothes, a black cravat and straw hat, ordering the adult males outside. The attackers were unmoved by the tearful pleas of the wives, including Mrs. Wilkinson's plea to spare her husband because she was ill with measles. Brown asked, "You have neighbors?" She said yes, but she had no way of contacting them. "It matters not," Brown replied, and forced her husband outside in stocking feet. Alan Wilkinson, William Sherman, John Doyle, and two Doyle sons were taken a short distance from their homes. Brown's men used their short, two-edged swords, whetted to razor sharpness, to hack the men to death. The next morning, the Sunday sun revealed the gruesome sight of the mangled forms. Arms and fingers were dismembered. Chests and faces were wounded. Throats were cut. The elder Doyle's body had a hole in the forehead where Brown had fired into the dead body. Down at Pottawatomie Creek lay the mutilated remains of William Sherman, his left hand hanging by a piece of skin and his skull split open, with some brain tissue washed away. The victims did not own slaves, but it did not matter to Brown. In his eyes, they were still the enemy, to be made an example of, to strike terror in the hearts of the pro-slavery people. He said, "It was better that a score of bad men should die than that one man who came here to make Kansas a free state." What Brown and his men did at Pottawatomie Creek shocked some of his sons and his men who had sat out the raid, as well as anti-slave settlers and Eastern abolitionists, who generally opposed violence. This raid caused Southerners to assume incorrectly that all Northerners were militant abolitionists. Even as Brown was leaving on the raid with four of his sons, John Brown Jr. had a bad feeling about what his father might do. He called out, "Father, be careful, and commit no rash acts." News of the massacre would later plunge him into temporary insanity. But Brown had already said caution was the same as cowardice. It was his God-given duty to strike back at the barbarians. When they had finished the killing, John's son, Owen Brown, who participated in the raid, said, "There shall be no more work as that." According to his brother Salmon, while returning from the raid, Owen felt terribly conscience-stricken because he had killed one of the Doyles, and he cried and took on at an agonizing rate. The disturbing news of what was done had reached Brown's men in camp ahead of the raiders. Upon return, Brown was met by his trembling son Jason, whose hatred of bloodletting caused John not to confide in him about such matters. Jason demanded of his father, "Did you have a hand in the killings?" Brown responded, "I did not do it, but I approved of it." Jason replied, "Whoever did it, it was an uncalled for wicked act." Annoyed, John fired back, "God is my judge. We were justified under the circumstances." But Brown wavered in his statements about the incident, stating once that he was probably responsible for the murders. On another occasion, he said the five victims were ordained by God to die. The Pottawatomie Creek killings did not intimidate pro-slavery settlers the way John had hoped. Instead, the incident incited them to chant for war and revenge, and to escalate the violence, as with a fatal attack upon a free stater with a hatchet and knives. They threw their victim at his doorstep, where his wife saw her mangled, dying husband and became hysterical. Authorities and pro-slavery forces' attempts to arrest or capture Old Brown would fail. One was a young cavalryman, James Ewell Brown Stewart, who would later assist in the capture of Brown at Harpers Ferry. The following months saw Brown fighting eagerly in Kansas's Civil War, which he helped bring about. Guerrilla activity included nightly raids, illegal acts, and atrocities by both sides, including Brown's encouraging his men to steal cattle and horses from pro-slavery settlers. In battle, he was a modern Gideon, defeating an opponent of greater numbers in the Battle of Blackjack on June 2, 1856. On August 30, 1856, Brown and fewer than two dozen men held off and escaped from more than 200 pro-slavery attackers, who destroyed Brown's home and those of other free staters in Osawatomie. With tears flowing down his cheeks, an angry Brown watched as fire devastated Osawatomie. He vowed he would die fighting slavery, and there would be no peace in the United States until slavery was ended. He said, "I will give them something else to do than extend slave territory. I will carry the war into Africa, the South." Even defeat in the Battle of Osawatomie did not blunt the emergence of the legend of John Brown as an exceptional military strategist, fearless anti-slavery warrior, and terrifier of the South. He emerged from this strife with new confidence in the sanctity of his crusade against slavery. Emerson, Thoreau, and others lauded him for his courage. Despite Brown's religiosity, his dedication to fighting slavery in Kansas led to the curtailment of his religious rituals. Salmon later wrote, "I never saw Father with a Bible or Testament in Kansas. He used to ask the blessing at mealtimes, but I never heard him pray in Kansas." Brown's life was not easy. Pro-slavery guerrillas murdered his son Frederick. Brown and his men were forced into hiding in the wilderness for long periods, enduring freezing weather, back-breaking labor, and food shortages, forcing them to eat whatever they could find, such as the toes of strange animals. Illness frequently laid up Brown and his men. These struggles took their toll on his health. He had been described as looking like an eagle, with a Romanesque nose, strong chin, stern mouth, and thick wiry hair on a disproportionately small head. His most captivating feature was his keen blue-gray eyes, which Frederick Douglass described as full of light and fire. But at this point in his life, his thin, sinewy frame made him seem much taller than his 5 feet 10 inches. He was stooped and emaciated, with a scrawny neck. At speaking engagements, he wore ragged woolen clothes and cowhide boots full of holes. The long, springing racehorse steps Douglas had observed were now a little slower. Privations had transformed Brown. He had maintained a capacity for hard work, but his holy war against the forces of evil aged him far beyond his 56 years. He was now Old Osawatomie Brown. The search for allies and money. The abatement of violence and the establishment of a degree of order led Brown to leave Kansas in November 1856. He returned to the East, but not primarily to visit his wife and younger children in North Elba, New York. He saw little of them from the mid-1850s, instead communicating by letter. Brown had to be careful even when traveling in the North. He was still a wanted man, being pursued by a U.S. Marshal. In a letter he wrote from Rochester, New York, in January 1858, Brown cautioned his wife and family, "Do not noise it about that I am in these parts." Brown traveled extensively throughout the North, seeking support for his crusade, especially from Eastern sympathizers known as the Secret Six. They were a mythic cabal of aristocratic Northern abolitionists who would help Brown hide from the law and provide financial assistance, but not as much of the latter as old Brown wanted. The Secret Six were men of outstanding social, educational, and financial standing. Four had degrees from Harvard, including Theodore Parker, who has been called one of the most impressive and learned Americans of his time. Parker knew 20 languages and had 16,000 volumes in his personal library. The Secret Six included two preachers, Thomas Wentworth Higginson, editor of the Atlantic Monthly, and Unitarian Theodore Parker, a world-renowned physician, Samuel Howe, two immensely wealthy gentlemen, eccentric Gerrit Smith and George Luther Stearns, and Franklin Sanborn, a young school teacher and secretary of the Anti-Slavery Massachusetts State Kansas Committee, who got married when his wife-to-be was on her deathbed. Upon meeting Brown in 1857, Sanborn was mesmerized by Brown's messianic zeal and introduced him to the other men. They would later call themselves the Secret Six. By 1858, Brown appeared ready to act, though he was vague when sharing details of his plans, even with the Secret Six. Brown wrote an Ohio congressman that slaves would be liberated by bloodshed. He revealed to others that he planned to go to Africa or China, his code words for the South. Brown had earlier revealed his Harpers Ferry plan in detail to Hugh B. Forbes, whom he had hired for $100 a month to train his Liberation Army. Forbes was a mercurial alcoholic soldier of fortune who desperately needed money. He was struggling to make ends meet as a fencing instructor, a translator, and a New York Daily Tribune reporter. Like Brown, Forbes was uncompromising and had failed at business. He fancied himself a military genius, having fought with Garibaldi in the failed Italian Revolution of 1848, and authored a 2-volume manual on military tactics, which he agreed to abridge for Brown's men. Forbes was captivated by Brown's idea of using guerrilla warfare to attack slavery. He was offered the job of Brown's drill master, but he envisioned becoming a general, perhaps a Garibaldi-like figure in the fight against slavery. But that was the role Brown planned to play. The relationship between the two soon deteriorated. Upon arriving in Kansas, Forbes found few recruits and spent weeks drilling only one man, Owen Brown. John Brown and Forbes competed for control of an almost non-existent army that lacked recruits, money, and weapons, and they argued heatedly over Brown's plan. From reading Garrison's Liberator, Brown incorrectly assumed that an attack on Harpers Ferry would send hundreds of slaves swarming to him, and he would arm them. Once Virginia was liberated, Brown would continue God's work by moving southward through Tennessee, Alabama, and elsewhere, taking arms from local arsenals to arm the slaves he freed, and easily dispatching any inefficient local militia foolish enough to confront him. Forbes repeatedly argued that slaves would not swarm to Brown, insisting a better way would be to have small forces attacking several times a week along the upper slave borders of Maryland and Virginia, freeing small groups of blacks and running them to Canada. This would gradually shrink slavery and shove its frontiers further south. After a little over a month with Brown, frustrated and disillusioned by the lack of salary and fulfillment of his dreams, Forbes convinced Brown he had pressing business in the East and received permission to leave Brown and rejoin him in several months. He never returned. Mimicking the American Revolutionary Experience. In the winter of 1858, Brown had an extended stay at Frederick Douglass's comfortable home in Rochester, New York, where he spent a week in a bedroom, sprawled on a soft bed with a board for a desk. He wrote and refined a provisional constitution that would create a new state in the southern Appalachians for the freedmen he planned to liberate during his invasion. During meals, Brown calmly explained the details of his invasion to Douglass. Douglass was shocked and horrified to hear of the destruction, violence, and terror resulting from a prolonged slave revolt. Brown was undaunted by his host's reaction and belief that Brown was overestimating the inclination of slaves to revolt. That spring, Brown convened a secret constitutional convention that met first in a schoolhouse and then in a Baptist church in Chatham, Canada, under the guise of forming a Masonic lodge for blacks. Brown saw the convention and his planned invasion as a response to a repressive institution that he considered a war on the enslaved. Here on May 8th to 10th, 1858, a group of 46 people, 12 whites and 34 blacks, adopted Brown's provisional constitution for a government he planned to establish in the soon-to-be-conquered territories. Dr. Martin R. Delaney chaired the meeting. He would become the highest-ranking African-American in the Union Army as a major. Delaney had been born in 1812 in Charlestown in Jefferson County, Virginia, only a couple of blocks away from where Brown would later be tried. The convention elected officials for the proposed new government, including Old Osawatomie Brown as its commander-in-chief. Patterned after the Declaration of Independence of 1776 and the U.S. Constitution of 1787, the Provisional Constitution and Ordinances for the People of the United States took its justification from the 1776 document and the mechanics of government from the 1787 Constitution. The preamble of Brown's document contends that slavery was a most barbarous, unprovoked, and unjustifiable act of war of one part of its citizens upon another portion, that it violated those eternal and self-evident truths set forth in our Declaration of Independence. Since the government allowed the continued subjugation of blacks, the preamble said, it was necessary for a while to create a provisional government. Like the existing central government, the provisional government would have three branches: legislative, one house of 5 to 10 representatives; executive, president and vice president; and judiciary, with a 5-member Supreme Court, all selected by voters. Executives and legislators would serve 3-year terms. The provisional president was not the commander-in-chief, a position Brown considered paramount, since the implementation of the provisional government, as well as slaves' freedom, would come about through the violence of guerrilla warfare. As the commander-in-chief, Brown's position was that of a fourth branch of the government. All legislation of the proposed government had to have the approval of not only the president, but also the commander-in-chief. The convention filled the remaining positions of the provisional government by electing capable John Henry Cagey, who would later be second in command at Harpers Ferry, as Secretary of War, eloquent Richard Ralph as Secretary of State, and George P. Gill, who had previously worked on a whaling ship in the Pacific, as Secretary of the Treasury. After the convention, Brown was ready to launch his attack on Virginia, but circumstances forced him to delay. A shortage of funds, the revelations of his disgruntled drill master, Hugh Forbes, and pressure from most of the Secret Six forced Brown to go to Kansas as a diversionary tactic. Distrustful of Forbes, Brown had earlier sent his young Secretary of State, Richard Ralph, an Englishman, poet, and journalist, from Kansas to New York to find out what Forbes was up to. Ralph never saw Forbes and became disenchanted with Brown's plans after reading Limitations of Human Responsibility by Dr. Wayland. Ralph returned to England, supporting himself by giving lectures. John Cook, one of Brown's recruits, mistakenly believed Ralph was collecting money for Brown. Ralph later returned to the United States, to New Orleans and Austin, Texas, but had no contact with Brown. In the meantime, feeling betrayed by Brown and the Secret Six, Forbes, whom Osborne P. Anderson, a free African-American who joined Brown, called Judas Forbes, had sent them abusive letters that warned of blackmail. He threatened to tell the world of Brown's plan if he was not paid. When the money failed to materialize, Forbes publicly exposed Brown's plan, denouncing his former employer and describing him to Senators William H. Seward and Henry Wilson as dangerous. Some of Brown's financial backers felt insecure because Forbes had blown their cover and Brown's, so the Virginia plan was temporarily abandoned. In late June 1858, Brown was back in Kansas, wearing a long gray beard and using the alias Shubal Morgan. In the summer and fall, he suffered from the intermittent fever and chills of ague, or malaria, and needed to buy some time. In late December, he launched a raid into Missouri. It was a limited assault on slavery. Brown and his men pillaged the homes of 2 Missouri planters, killing 1 of the planters, freeing 11 slaves, and carrying off wagons, horses, mules, and other property as reparations for those he was liberating. He then marched the 11 free blacks for 82 days and 1,100 miles through the dead of winter to safety in Canada. They arrived in mid-March 1859. Brown was pleased with his efforts. In a way, the raid was a rehearsal for an attack on Harper's Ferry. On January 22, 1859, the New York Daily Tribune printed a letter from Brown describing his recent raid and claiming, 11 persons are forcibly restored to their natural and inalienable rights, with but one man killed, and all hell is stirred from beneath. All pro-slavery, conservative, free state, and doughface men and administration tools are filled with holy horror. In John Brown's war against slavery, Robert McGlone points out that the panic Brown created with the Missouri raid inspired him to do more than just run off slaves to the north. He abandoned the subterranean plan to run off slaves through the mountains for a more dramatic scheme to produce panic among slaveholders. He intended to implement the plan he had discussed with Forbes, swift nightly raids on plantations to build up a large force that would seize weapons from Harpers Ferry, moving southward and establishing bases in the Appalachians, and conducting raids on the lowlands. This would create terror, his primary weapon to destabilize slavery, and ultimately embroil the nation in civil war. But Brown's failed efforts to entice black recruits would prove a factor in forcing him to reverse the order of his plan. First, he would assault the Federal Armory at the confluence of Potomac and Shenandoah Rivers with only a meager force. Brown's raiding and guerrilla activities led to talk of rewards being placed on his head. The governor of Missouri proposed a $3,000 bounty, but he was unable to get his legislature's consent. The U.S. president offered a $250 reward for the troublesome raider. Acting unperturbed, the game old man strode about in the north, pledging that he would die before being captured. Ridiculing the meager amount of his bounty, he jokingly and defiantly issued a $2.50 reward for the delivery of President James Buchanan to any northern jail. Chapter 2. Launching the War of Liberation. After leaving Missouri in January 1859, Brown traveled throughout the Northeast again, seeking supporters and giving fiery speeches. By early June, he had urged the completion of a weaponry order he had placed 2 years earlier, and arranged for his Ohio weapons and ammunition stores to be moved to Chambersburg, Pennsylvania. He made what turned out to be a last visit to his family in North Elba, New York. Then, in early July, under the alias of Isaac Smith, Brown headed for Harper's Ferry. Brown targeted the Harper's Ferry area not only because of the Federal Armory and its weapons, but because of information he recovered from black people who had lived nearby. He believed he could count on support from the high percentage of local free black people and anti-slavery whites, Quakers and Germans from Pennsylvania who were sympathetic to the Underground Railroad. The railroad, or the Great Black Way, ran through Harper's Ferry, countering the slaveholders from Tidewater, Virginia, including members of prominent families such as the Washingtons, Lees, and Pages. To compensate for the loss of numerous runaways, in 1835, the Virginia legislature incorporated the Virginia Slave Insurance Company at Charlestown, and unsuccessfully urged Pennsylvania to rescind its personal liberty law of 1826, which blocked the return of runaways, and instead enact legislation enabling the recapture of fugitive slaves. Few free blacks or slaves worked in the armory, arsenal, or rifle works at the time of Brown's raid. They labored nearby, in the iron industry north of the Potomac River. The number of free blacks increased as the iron industry near Harper's Ferry sharply declined in the 1850s. By the end of the decade, it was bankrupt. Many enslaved iron workers were sold, and others purchased their freedom, staying in the area and working in the lumber industry and railroad. They formed black communities and churches, creating a seemingly favorable milieu for Brown to launch his war of liberation. Brown had contact with men from Harper's Ferry, including Dr. Martin Delaney, who had chaired the Chatham Convention. Another free black man, Joseph Richard Winters, born in Leesburg, Virginia, arranged a meeting between Frederick Douglass and Brown at the stone quarry in Chambersburg in 1859. Fugitives who used the Underground Railroad that ran northward through the sites of the iron furnaces swelled the black population of Chambersburg, making it an important conduit for the movement of men and weapons to the farm. Brown's Liberation Army. On July 3, 1859, Brown, his sons Owen and John Jr., and Jeremiah Anderson, a recruit from Kansas, got off the train at Sandy Hook, Maryland, across the Potomac, and about a mile east of Harpers Ferry. They spent the night in this narrow hamlet. The next morning, on Independence Day, Brown and his companions set out on a quest to buy land for a dollar or two an acre. Soon they encountered a local resident. Brown introduced himself as Isaac Smith, and his three companions as his sons, and he inquired about the price of land. He found the local price of $15 to $20 an acre too high, but a resident gave him a tip about a farm around 5 miles north of Harpers Ferry. Brown leased the farm from the widow of Dr. Booth Kennedy for $35 in rent through March 1, 1860. The agreement gave him the use of 2 houses, pasture for a cow and a horse, and firewood. The main house sat upon a rise 300 yards north of the road, and 600 yards from it, across the road, was a cabin in a low swampy area, mostly hidden by shrubbery. By the second week of July, Brown and his three companions occupied their new base. As summer turned to early fall, small numbers of anti-slavery men gravitated to the small rented farmhouse that served as the headquarters and staging area for Brown's war. Many of them were experienced veterans of Brown's guerrilla band in Kansas. 21 men in all, 16 white and 5 black, would answer Brown's call and form the small army of the provisional government. They looked upon old Osawatomie, whom they also called uncle and captain, with respect that emanated not only from an admiration for their leader's certainty of purpose and hatred of the peculiar institution, but also from his bravery and willingness to die for the cause. They openly embraced Brown's creed that slavery could only be abolished by violence. Not all these men embraced his theology. John H. Cagey was an agnostic, and Aaron Dwight Stevens opposed slavery on moral rather than religious grounds. Jeremiah Anderson was described by his former high school teacher as quiet and studious, but morose and eccentric. It was assumed he would become a minister, but he rejected the idea and became a freethinker with spiritualist tendencies. The religious views of Canadian-born Stuart Taylor also differed from Brown's. Taylor's behavior was the most unique, causing Annie Brown Adams to describe him years later as generous and kind-hearted, but a crank, a fanatic, an eccentric dreamer who had opinions on all subjects that he called progressive ideas that made him the constant victim of jokes by the others, which he always took good-naturedly. Annie Brown Adams found him to be a constant student, reading everything he could lay his hands upon, interested in all the isms of the day, and in his religious views more of a spiritualist than anything else. The men who gathered at the Kennedy House were not uneducated, uncouth ruffians, but a few had run afoul of the law. Most had some education and were idealistic men in their 20s. The average age was 25. They were probably a little naive, but were fired with youthful enthusiasm and righteous indignation. When the wife of the good-natured and fun-loving William Thompson pleaded with him not to go to Harper's Ferry for fear he would be murdered, his response was harsh. "Oh, Mary, you do not think of anything but self. What is my life in comparison to the thousands of poor slaves in bondage?" 13 of the recruits had fought with Brown in Kansas. Brown's right-hand man, John H. Cagey, was gifted in speech and pen. The self-educated 22-year-old attorney had been forced to flee from the school teaching job he started at 17 in Shenandoah County, Virginia, because of anti-slavery views. During his early life, Cagey was a correspondent for the National Era of Washington, D.C., and the Evening Post and editor of the Topeka Tribune. He was imprisoned for several months for fighting in Kansas's Civil War, and later was severely injured by a pro-slave judge whom he had criticized for pro-slavery bias. The judge struck K.G. over the head with a cane and knocked him down on the courthouse steps. In self-defense, a dazed K.G. wounded his assailant by shooting him in the groin. Later, the judge shot K.G. on sight. K.G.'s life was miraculously spared when the bullet that struck above his heart was slowed by an inch-thick memorandum book. The bullet penetrated K.G.'s coat and the book and stopped at a rib. K.G. is said to have removed the bullet with a penknife, causing the judge to say, according to a witness, that if he had known K.G. possessed so much pluck, he would have invited him to dinner. Brown's most trusted assistant possessed such talents as organizational and executive skills, eloquence in writing and oratory, and total indifference to his personal appearance. A fellow raider, Osborne Anderson, describes K.G. as often going out with a slouched hat, one leg of his pantaloons properly adjusted, and the other partly tucked into his high boot top, unbrushed, unshaven, and in utter disregard of the latest style. When K.G. arrived at Harpers Ferry, he planned to stay at the Kennedy House, but was recognized. His reputation had spread to the region around Harpers Ferry, so most of his time from mid-July to mid-October was spent at Mary Rittner's boarding house on 225 East King Street in Chambersburg, Pennsylvania. There, he coordinated the shipping of weapons, letters, and men to the Kennedy farm and received a number of visits by Brown. Henry, as he was known, frequently attended to deliveries at the railroad depot, where he attracted attention. The town's newspaper, Valley Spirit, reported, "Henry was about the depot at the arrival of every train, and was observed to scrutinize closely the passengers as they left the cars. He frequently met among the passengers a person with whom he seemed to be acquainted. They appeared very shy with each other at first meeting, but generally left the depot together." The seat of Franklin County, Chambersburg, was a key junction for bringing both men and weapons for the raid. The town's population of 4,000 included 500 free black people, in part because Pennsylvania was a haven for runaway slaves. Brown's men and weapons arrived by rail over the Cumberland Valley Railroad, and although the rail line went closer to the Kennedy farm, it was a poorly maintained track to Hagerstown in the slave state of Maryland. Brown deemed it prudent to use wagons to transport recruits and weapons, hidden in boxes, from Chambersburg to the Kennedy farm. These included 200 Sharps rifles that were meant to be loaned to free state settlers in Kansas. These became embroiled in controversy between the National Kansas Committee and Massachusetts State Committee over ownership and the propriety of giving them to Brown. When considering whether to give Brown the money and weapons he had requested, the National Kansas Committee asked whether he intended to invade Missouri or any slave state. Candor would have imperiled his plans, so he adamantly refused to answer, saying, "I do not reveal my plans. No one knows them but myself. I do not wish to be interrogated. If you wish to give me anything, I want you to give it freely. I have no other purpose but to serve the cause of liberty." Ultimately, George Stearns, as president of the Massachusetts State Kansas Committee and provider of funds for the purchase of weaponry, gained possession of the rifles and gave them to Brown. He had them shipped from Springdale, Iowa, to John Brown Jr.'s home in Ashtabula County, Ohio, along with 200 revolvers Stearns had bought. Brown's son had the weapons secreted about Ohio, in a store under coffins for sale, and in a haymow, before they were shipped to the Kennedy farm. K.G. stayed at the Chambersburg boarding house run by Mrs. Mary Rittner, the widow of Abram Rittner, who was the son of a former anti-slavery governor of Pennsylvania. At the boarding house, Keiji could see the garden from the open window of his rented room. Mrs. Rittner complained that a neighbor's miserable canine was once again trampling her garden, so her boarder took his pistol and proved his marksmanship.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.